Good morning. It is such a pleasure to be here in Vancouver. I'm so pleased at those kind remarks. Usually we make people happy at USDOT by sending money. And we do that, and they are happy about it. I'm not entirely happy right now having to follow Deputy Mayor Nadeau. That was really quite profound, and she represents what this great city is doing in the area of livability and health, and really setting an example for the rest of this country as to what the future holds in transportation. So, very impressive, and I'm so glad I was here to hear that. It is also my great pleasure to be here representing Secretary Anthony Fox, who has done similar things for our nation in terms of setting an example and a direction for what transportation needs to be in the 21st century in the United States. I know it's not exactly the same group, but I wanted to congratulate this year's APBP award recipients. All of them have done outstanding work and are more than deserving of these important awards. Notably, Dan Goodman. By the end of June 2015, USDOT had completed 52 safety assessments, one for each state, the District of Columbia, and Puerto Rico. In March 2015, Secretary Fox launched the Mayor's Challenge component of the Safer People, Safer Streets Initiative. This was a call to action for mayors and elected officials to take significant steps to improve safety for bicyclists and pedestrians of all ages and abilities. 246 communities joined the challenge and made a commitment to improving bicyclist and pedestrian safety by issuing a public statement about the importance of bicycle and pedestrian safety, forming local action teams to advance safety and accessible goals, and taking local action. Over the last year and a half, USDOT has provided resources and assistance to communities in making progress on these seven challenge activities. Of the communities that reported their progress to USDOT through a survey and/or awards application, we have been able to document the following outcomes from the Mayor's Challenge. 12 communities reported adopted complete streets policies. Many cities conducted road safety assessments, took inventories of existing pedestrian and bicycle facilities, and created safer street crossings. Cities installed 36 new systems to count pedestrians and cyclists, and 14 cities collected survey data from pedestrians and bicyclists. Many cities developed new design standards and manuals, taking advantage of the design flexibility, and they started redesigning their streets using road diets and separated bike lanes to improve safety for pedestrians and bicyclists. 11 cities reported that they constructed more than 370 miles of pedestrian and bicycle lanes. More than 40 cities reported on safety education, including several educational programs for school-age kids, which reached over 10,000 students. So we have been busy, but we are far from finished. This Friday, we are holding a summit at USDOT headquarters in Washington to bring together mayors and other representatives from among the 246 cities participating in the Mayor's Challenge. We will be recognizing cities that have made the most progress during the challenge with awards in each challenge area, as well as Secretary's award for overall excellence. USDOT will continue to provide leadership, funding, resources, and other support to promote safe walking and bicycling. We are in the process of institutionalizing department-wide collaborative efforts and establishing a set of goals and metrics to help us track national progress on pedestrian and bicycle activity and safety on an annual basis. So we've been busy, but we're looking for ways to be even busier. Progress doesn't happen without effort and without commitment. Despite this progress, we know that road fatalities in the U.S. increased last year to more than 35,000. The increase in pedestrian and bicyclist fatalities was especially significant. We are dedicated to reducing this number. At USDOT, safety is our top priority, and this applies to all modes of travel. Any roadway fatality is too many. which is why our goal will always be zero deaths. We have made great progress in so many ways, but the bottom line in 2015 was that more people died than the previous year. Clearly, we need to work harder and smarter. America's roads can and must be safer for all who use them, regardless of mode of travel. We are working with new partners to use new methods to analyze the crash data and determine the most effective ways to bring those fatalities down. We will be discussing ways to reduce roadway fatalities on Friday, how we can determine the cause of the increase, and to redouble our efforts to address them. As I said, safety is our top priority, and that has never been more clear than now. USDOT will continue to provide leadership, funding, resources, and other support to promote safe walking and bicycling. We are also institutionalizing our collaboration throughout the USDOT and establishing a set of goals and performance metrics to track national progress on pedestrian and bicycle activity safety each and every year. Today, the Federal Highway Administration is announcing its strategic agenda for pedestrian and bicycle transportation. As I speak, it's being posted on our website, www.federalhighway.gov. It sets out two aspirational goals: reduce pedestrian and bicycle fatalities and serious injuries by 80% in 15 years, and strive for zero pedestrian and bicycle fatalities and serious injuries in the next 20 to 30 years. Also, increase the percentage of short trips represented by bicycling and walking to 30% by the year 2025. This will indicate a 50% increase over where things are since 2009. Our team has spent the last 2 years developing this document, which will help guide the work of the Federal Highway Administration over the next 3 to 5 years, to ensure that the progress we've made will not slow down. It is organized around 4 goals: networks, safety, equity, and trips. And each goal includes activities related to capacity building, policy data, and research. It emphasizes the use of existing resources and building on the policy statement on bicycle and pedestrian accommodations. The volume and type of activities it includes demonstrates Federal Highway's ongoing leadership on multimodal transportation and represents our commitment to institutionalize and mainstream these issues going forward. We're promoting pedestrian and bicycle planning, design, and safety resources, convening peer exchange and other outreach, updating policies, fostering active public participation in the planning and decision-making process, and leading pedestrians in bicycle assessments and audits. All of these things are essential to what I call institutionalizing this commitment and ensuring that it is ongoing. The commitment is ongoing. The resources are ongoing. And I think this has broadened across the spectrum. I think some of the most ardent advocates for bicycle and pedestrian safety and access in cities are business leaders, because they've learned and seen the impact it can have on their community, on their customers, on their quality of life. So institutionalizing these practices within institutions like USDOT and Federal Highway, and importantly, state departments of transportation and local transportation agencies around our country, is how we're going to continue this commitment and ongoing momentum behind what has been really, I think, an extraordinary movement. So we're ensuring accessibility for all users while also pushing innovation by identifying and filling gaps in knowledge and practice, promoting design flexibility, encouraging and facilitating experimentation, and conducting new research. I want to wrap up by talking a little bit about my boss and something called ladders of opportunity. Planning is really where opportunities lie. And we are actively encouraging American communities to plan for the needs of a growing bike and pedestrian population. Our culture is shifting in that direction, as it is in many countries. One of the most important opportunities you have in planning for the future is to reverse or avoid some of the errors that really were made in the past. We have to learn from those mistakes. Secretary Fox has started a national conversation about the link between transportation and opportunity. He encourages us to think of transportation not just as a way to get from point A to point B, but as ladders of opportunity, linking people safely and efficiently to a job, to an education, to their doctor, or to anything that impacts their quality of life in a community. Offering safe places for bicyclists and pedestrians to travel is central to this philosophy. We are connecting people to opportunity. Secretary Fox has made a lasting contribution by putting this subject high on the public agenda. This is not just a professional issue for the Secretary. For him, it's very personal. He grew up in a neighborhood in Charlotte, North Carolina, that was essentially trapped between two interstates. It limited access to the neighborhood, discouraged grocery stores, pharmacies, and other businesses from opening there. It also had a psychological impact. It gave the people who lived there a sense that they were second-class citizens. This problem was certainly not limited to Charlotte. And it wasn't just because of interstate highways. Airports, railroads, transit facilities have divided communities, damaged local businesses, and cut people off from opportunities they deserve. But again, those were mistakes and sins of the past. We've learned a lot since then. However, focusing on pedestrian and bicycle networks has a unifying effect. They create community and unite instead of divide. As we look to the future and make transportation decisions that will have long-lasting impact, decades, in some cases a century, the Secretary urges us to consider both the big picture and the small picture, the macro and the micro perspectives. The big picture, of course, is the interstate's unquestioned role in supporting the national economy and linking the United States together. But on the micro side, we need to take into account the historical impact, often harmful, it had on individual neighborhoods and communities, and explore options for reconnecting communities that will have long-term benefits. The bicycle and pedestrian community has long championed community-based solutions like these, and the Secretary and I do too, because they work. We have a chance to rebuild the system so it works for everyone in all communities, connecting people to opportunity without harming people in its path and building projects by, for, and with the impact of the communities that are impacted by it. Secretary Fox has called upon me, as Federal Highway Administrator, my team, his teams in all the modes, and all of us to accept this new challenge and make the kind of transportation decisions by which everyone in every community will benefit. The Secretary directed and produced something called Beyond Traffic 2045. And basically his objective was to develop an analysis of what's coming, what we can expect in our country with respect to transportation and the needs of transportation in the 21st century. A couple of basic statistics have really reshaped the dialogue we're having in the United States. One was, in the next 30 years, a growth of 70 million people in our population that is going to generate a 45% increase in freight movement as a result of that demand. And that 70 million population growth will occur in about 11 mega regions of our country, basically tied to the reurbanization of America, where millennials want to be in the future, and how our transportation system needs to adapt to those trends and changing demographic realities. And I think what the sector has done with Beyond Traffic has really redefined the conversation we're having in America about the future of transportation, because what it says is, in order for our economy to thrive without choking us with a 45% increase in freight, in some cities in America, some sort of urban freight hubs, that could be as high as 60 to 70% on a system that today isn't capable of handling the kind of impact that freight has. So we have got massive investment to make in systems that will relieve the congestion that will be caused by these, what I call, forces of nature. This is coming. It's going to happen. I was freight roundtable yesterday that I hosted in St. Louis. It was the 24th and last of 24 cities across America focusing on this challenge, on the challenge of how to move freight. My colleague, Chip Janikin, who's the administrator of our marine agency, was there as well. We talked about it at $50 million investment USDOT had made in the marine highway and was going to divert thousands of trucks from the highway onto water. A system that is thoroughly underutilized and a system we're going to have to maximize the capacity of in order to relieve the congestion on the highways and ensure that the impact of that growth doesn't choke us but creates ladders of opportunity. That demand is going to present an economic boom for the nation if we invest in the right systems to handle the growth. So all of that is ahead of us. You have charted a path to looking at community-based solutions that improve the lives of people and improve the economy. So you're to be congratulated for the work you've done, the work you're going to do. It contributes mightily to ensuring that we can move people and goods and improve the quality of life in communities at the same time because of what we learned. So keep up the good work. Thank you so much. Secretary Fox, can't be more grateful for the work certainly you're all doing in the United States and the work we're all doing together around the world, because every day, every month, every year, we're learning from each other. So thank you very much, and I certainly hope you enjoy the rest of your conference.
Thank you, Administrator Nadeau. Thank you for your leadership, your continued embrace of active transportation, and I think equally as important, those of you who do not work in government don't appreciate how hard it is for employees of government to travel to the conference. It's extraordinarily difficult. They have a lot of internal regulations about where they can go, how much they can spend, and so on. So it's especially critical that we get FHWA staff and USDOT staff here participating, talking to us, learning from us, understanding what our needs are and what's happening on the ground. So you're to be commended for that. Okay, next we've got a man who needs no introduction, which is good because we don't have a lot of time to introduce him, and you probably know him already. So I'd like to welcome to the stage Charles Montgomery of Happy City fame.
Awesome introduction. Okay, so I'm supposed to be the happy guy to get you all cheered up and going in the morning, and I couldn't help but feel extremely angry during the last presentation, and I'm going to be gracious and hold my thoughts on that. But I'm actually kind of charged a little bit by something else I heard earlier this week. Okay, so I live alone, and I'm a single guy, and I'm on Tinder, and I'm having a chat with this handsome dude, and I'm like, so are you gonna go to placemaking week and go to some of the events around pro? And this is what I get. He's not gonna come because it's just not relevant. It's annoying when there are people dying, starving, addicted on our streets. He's talking about the inequity and the urgent unfairness in our city. So I was totally deflated. We didn't go on a date. And it kind of got me thinking, you know, here you are. This is what people think of us today. And actually, to be honest with you, I was kind of feeling sparkly and rainbowy myself, going like, the gathering of the tribes, we're all going to be here, we're going to go on the bike rave, we're going to have these street parties, we're going to change space, we're going to feel wonderful, we're going to hug. And, you know, maybe he's right. So it got me thinking about Vancouver. So from those of you who are outside of Vancouver, and I know most of you here don't live in our city, and you're just thinking, my God, it's so beautiful here. You're doing so much right. It's so connected. Well, yeah, we are, but if you're not following local news, what you may not see, so let me introduce you to our city. We have a crisis of homelessness, and it's getting worse. By the end of this year, I think Councillor deals it, something like 2,000 people close to that will be living on the streets or close to it in Vancouver, despite our efforts. We have a crisis of people being pushed out of our city. The middle class is being pushed out. This picture is a year old, right? So last year, you needed $1 million to buy a home in Vancouver. Now we're up to 1.7. I don't know. It's a nightmare. People are being pushed out of the city. This has implications. We are having a crisis. People are dying on our streets. We have a crisis of addiction and overdose deaths. I think now we're up to 78 in the city of Vancouver this year alone. And we know that all these things are connected, particularly on the idea of addictions and overdoses. This has to do, to a great degree, with social disconnection and lack of social support and connections in our city. So, how are you feeling now? Thinking about my Tinder friend, you know, he's right. And he's right in this way. If we are not activists, if we are not working towards cities that are more fair, that are healthier for everyone, that are more inclusive, then we're failing. And if you're not working towards that, here's what I suggest. After this, you just leave the conference, the grouse grind is there, go hike, put on your Lululemon, and have a great time. Or let's work on this together. So, okay, calm down. I spent 10 years being super poor in order to write this book, looking at the connection between urban design and human health and happiness. And now I'm really lucky to be working with a team of people here and around the world who are looking specifically at these connections. And our work has led us to conclude that indeed the way we design spaces and cities and systems has a tremendous effect on health and happiness. And indeed our cities are designing our well-being. And when I'm speaking about happiness, I am talking about everything that matters to human well-being. And we need to start repairing the damage we've done over the last 100 years and create places and systems that nurture all of us. So, I did mention the word happiness. And so when I do that, typically, and we're talking about happiness in mobility and in placemaking, you know, first you have to define what do you mean by this word, happiness? How do you measure it? We've been thinking about this for a couple of thousand years, since the time of Aristotle, right? We kind of went off track a couple hundred years ago in the Enlightenment when scholars tried to measure pleasure and pain and they failed, and that's when our friends, the economists, stepped up and said, don't worry, we got this one, right? You can't measure pleasure or pain, but let's just watch how people spend their money and that'll tell us what makes them happy. Which, that sounded pretty reasonable at the time. So now we have a world where war, cancer, divorce, all these things are supposed to be good for human well-being because they increase economic activity. The economists have been, coming around. And so, sorry, do we have any economists in the room? Hands up, please. Yes, okay, economists here. What does this mean? Okay, I'm gonna translate what you're thinking. This is from Gary Becker, the Nobel Prize-winning economist. So the economists have been coming around, and here we go. This is an equation to explain the evolutionary happiness function. So we're all going to try and get happier by getting more stuff and growing our own social status, and it's going to work for a while, and then it's going to stop, and we'll go back to where we started, and we're not going to get any happier in the end pursuing that vein of happiness. So huge downer from the economists. In fact, we're lucky that scientists and researchers have actually been searching for evidence on the connection between environment, behavior, human bodies, and human well-being. And we're learning a lot. For example, we're learning that people who say they are happy actually have better health outcomes, they're more productive at work, they live longer. So, you know, happiness is not such a bad thing, maybe not such a bad complement to GDP. So I want to tell you what my team and I do. We pull lessons from various disciplines. So we're pulling from public health, from psychology, from neuroscience, and behavioral economics, because the economists are now using data from neuroscience, from other fields, comparing that to societal and environmental conditions, and they're starting to learn some things about how the world actually works. We're learning from sociology, and we're learning from other disciplines, including things like performance art, actually. I'm not going to give you the recipe for urban happiness today. There's no time. And there's this awesome book you can read all about that, which is for sale outside here for only half an hour after my talk, and I'll sign books. But I want to talk about what matters most. And then thinking back to I kept calling my friend, we didn't actually meet, this person's critique. What matters most to urban well-being? And it's actually pretty straightforward, and the word is mentioned already today. We know that social connection matters more than anything else for happiness and for health. We know that people who are socially connected to family and to friends, again, more productive at work, more likely to survive cancer, they get sick less often, their communities are more resilient, they live on average 15 years longer than people who are socially connected. So social connections do matter. It's not just unicorns and rainbows. Hammer home that point. We know that superficial contact or light contact out in the city matters just as much as contact with family and friends. So this is research from Elizabeth Dunn at UBC. She sent her students to measure the effects, the well-being effects at the end of the day on people as they had social interactions throughout the city, superficial interactions. And the people who maximized those casual encounters with people they didn't know so well were just as happy at the end of the day as people who were spending a lot of time with family and friends. So this means a lot. And this was true also for introverts. We know that there's a strong correlation between social trust in neighbors, and happiness or subjective well-being across Canadian cities. And here you see, if you don't know Canada, you'll know that, you know, St. John is a humble little ville on the other end of Canada, not very wealthy. And our big, rich cities are all down at the bottom of life satisfaction and trust in neighbors. And, you know, my East Vancouver socialist buds are like, see, money doesn't matter. Money really matters. It's just that the social aspect matters more. It overwhelms it. Coming back to that notion of health and well-being, our American friends will recall the heat wave that hit the U.S. Midwest around 1996 in the summer, three incredibly hot days, 700 people died in Chicago in the course of a weekend. Who died? Well, the people who died all had one thing in common. They were socially disconnected. Nobody cared about them. Nobody visited them. So this stuff really is about life and death. Sociability matters. One more thing. My mentor, this crazy mayor called Enrique Peñalosa, who's finally been re-elected mayor of Bogota, when he insisted on using his term to make a happier city, his program was based on the notion that the city must include everyone, it must welcome everyone. He had no evidence at the time to actually back up what he was saying. But in fact, he was right. There's this powerful connection between inclusion and societal well-being. You know, read the spirit level in the UK. And this comes right down, now we're learning there's a relationship between inclusion and brain activity. I have a real hard time explaining this one. Okay, full disclosure, this is a mouse's brain, not a human's brain. But what they're learning that in all kinds of mammals, when you are low in social status, it increases feelings of social isolation. It changes the networks in your brain and it makes it harder to re-engage. We also know that people who are either excluded or low in status, they die sooner, even if they get the same healthcare benefits as, say, in the UK. So inclusion really matters. When we're talking about sociability, think about that notion of status and who's included. So we know that our cities are actually designing our social lives. Something I'm kind of sad about, well, very happy about, but sad about, I can't talk to you about all the super duper cool experiments we've been doing over the past couple of years on looking at the sociability and well-being effects of public spaces and cities, because we're experimenting on you this week. We are working with the Urban Realities Lab, the neuroscientists at the University of Waterloo, along with MODIS and the City of Vancouver, on this super cool experiment. And I should be recruiting you right now, but I don't need to because it's totally booked out. So if you're really desperate to join, maybe you could sneak by the sign-up booths at one of those times listed here, and if there are dropouts, you can join in. Anyway, which is just to say that I can't tell you about our experiments because I would be priming those of you who are participating and it will change the results. So do you understand? Is that okay? Okay. But other people are learning things. We know, for example, from studies in Italy that people over the age of 50 and women are taking fewer antidepressants when they live in walkable, connected neighborhoods. We know we can kind of extrapolate from work by the great Larry Frank out at UBC, who found this negative correlation between floor space ratio, FAR, or whatever you want to call it, density, and sense of community. No, positive correlation. The extrapolation is this. What we figure is that the more parking you have in front of buildings, the less people's sense of community and connections is. And the reasons are pretty obvious, right? Pretty intuitive. Back to Chicago. Remember what I mentioned, the people who died in Chicago in the heat waves, they had one thing in common, it was social disconnection. But as people began to dig into the data and the urban connections over the years after that terrible tragedy, what they found was that you take two neighborhoods, both of them poor, different urban fabric. One is a connected neighborhood with lots of small shops and services, things for people to go to. The other one destroyed by the high modernists, big box, you know, wide roads, etc. The death rate was 10 times as high in the disconnected neighborhood. So again, we're talking about public health and saving lives here. Thinking about the placemaking side here, just up the street here, I don't know which direction I'm pointing. I mean to point west. Over in the West End, you know, you can walk out, if you stick around this weekend, to the farmer's market. It's lovely. It's drawing people out into the streets. And that's all very rah, rah, rah. But if you really want to understand the power of placemaking to improve well-being in a city, don't go there. Walk east. I want you to walk east to this on Saturday. Or Councilor Deal, is Saturday or Sunday? Every day. It's a big mess. This is on the downtown east side. It really is. It's Canada's poorest postal code. And for years now, vendors, scavengers, dumpster divers have been appropriating the sidewalk to create their own market. And it is quite messy, it's quite gritty, and it's intimidating for our American friends who don't understand that not everybody out there has guns, right? Because you might think so. But now this has been formalized, and they're taking a public park to do the same thing. And this is a public health intervention. People who don't have living rooms, people who live in hotel rooms down there, are using public space, not just to trade, not just to make a living, but they're coming together and developing community in these spaces. And we as a city, yeah, thank you. So I just kind of shut you down halfway through the applause. Yay! We as a city can learn so much from this neighborhood, even as we endanger it. So I think it's worth stepping back and talking about who are the original placemakers. They are usually people who are vulnerable. They are usually people who are threatened. Here in Vancouver, in the downtown east side, this was an old department store called Woodward's that was shut down in 1992, I believe. The neighborhood was in decline, and of course, we wanted to do what we always do here. We wanted to build condos, and lots of them. We wanted to get rich off this site. People in the neighborhoods said, hell no. There was a squat. They got kicked out of that. They built a tent city around, and they said, you're not getting rid of us. And they were so persistent that finally, various levels of government, the provincial government, maybe the feds, the city of Vancouver, a university, nonprofits who deal with issues of homelessness and housing, and even some developers, all got together to create a solution. And here's what their solution looks like. This is Woodward's. If you're from out of town, you must visit this weekend. Corner of Hastings and Abbott. And Carol, yeah. So what you see is you see market condos, fancy market condos at the back there. You see subsidized family housing on the right. You have housing for the hard to house. These are people with mental illness, drug addiction, people who tend to be very hard on the building. You've got a university, you've got offices, you've got grocery, retail. It's all there. And you're thinking, why are you talking to me about housing? Where are the placemaking and mobility people? Because of this. It's all joined together in the middle by this fantastic public space with very expensive, high-status public art on both ends of it. It's a covered place. Why? Because you may not believe this if you're not from here, but it actually rains here 8 months a year, and it's going to start in 3 days and never stop. So this is a living room for people who don't have a living room. This is a space designed specifically to welcome all people in the city. As long as you are not using, as long as you don't have a needle in your arm as you walk in, you're welcome here. You should be. If you're not Councillor of Deal, you better do something about this. I don't mean you're using it. Anyway, this place matters to me because when one third of our nation got together a month ago, Canadian moment, just about to burst into tears at the mention of the tragic hit. When we got together, this was the place that so many of us got together to watch this concert that was broadcast nationally. And you look around that room and you see the full spectrum of our city. Everybody was there. Everybody was welcome. And it was a beautiful thing. Okay, so thinking again about that Tinder message, thinking again about inequity, who's included, who isn't included. It's such a treat for you all, and I hope you enjoy your walking and biking tours over the next few days, looking at the wonderful things that are happening here in the core of the city. But here's what we know, is that our cities are becoming places, places where more and more people proportionately are being excluded from those experiences. Cities around the world are becoming more dispersed at a rate of something like 2% per year. Even as core cities get better. So it's a question of equity. Who enjoys this experience? Who enjoys the healthy, connected, walkable ease that people enjoy down here? Well, fewer and fewer. And so looking at the well-being effects of systems of mobility and urban planning, we can't get past that. It's important to consider. We know, for example, that driving alone on long commutes, the further you go, in time, the lower people's self-reported well-being tends to be. The longer we drive, the unhappier we are. Why is that? Why is that? You're looking at yourself, aren't you? The Vancouver Sun reported that people who are driving are reporting experiencing more rudeness and civility than people moving in any other way around the city. So that's only part of the negative well-being effects of driving or any kind of long commute. The other part is this. I'm not going to explain this. It just gives you a headache in the morning. Keywords, American geographers, millions of data points, big American cities, what did they learn? The greatest factor limiting people's ability to meet in big American cities is very simple. They call it dispersal, the degree to which functions of the city are spread out across the miles. So as we talk about building wonderful microspaces, people are being left out because they have no access to those spaces because they're stuck in their vehicles or on buses. So it's important to discuss really briefly the system effects of these kinds of the kinds of places we've been building. I'm going to go through this really quickly and get back to the social. Because we have some Americans in the room, let's pick on you for a while. We're looking in the Atlanta region. Atlanta, you do sprawl better than anybody else. So on the left, you've got Mableton out on the fridge. Out on the fringe. This is a place where you try to get an A to B, and you punch it into Google, and Google's like, there are no sidewalks if you're walking, so don't bother. And then you have Midtown, north of downtown, right? Close, walkable, connected neighborhood. I don't know, think West End or think West 4th, medium dense. Near a denser neighborhood where you can walk to all of your needs. It's all connected. The park is there. The transit's nearby. Super fast. What are the system effects of these two different neighborhoods? Again, partly because of the great work of Lawrence Frank at UBC, we know things like this. You're going to emit 2 times the greenhouse gas living in the dispersed neighborhood. Boom. Spend twice as much just getting around. Coming back to the Vancouver region, thinking of that data point, we talk about unaffordability in this city, and people say, well, you know, all you have to do is drive till you qualify, move out to the edges. Well, look at this extremely ancient piece of data, and I say ancient because housing prices here have gone up more than 20% in the last year. So 2015 is old, but Andy Yan at Bing Tom Architects analyzed this. The blue spaces are million-dollar homes in Vancouver. And you think, well, let's just go out to the burbs. Let's go out to auto-drivable land. And let's see if we can afford it out there. The blue dots are all over the place as you head out into the nodes in our agricultural land reserve. It's more expensive to live out there. So people are being made vulnerable by this extreme cost of transportation. Okay, you're gonna weigh 10 pounds more because you can't walk anywhere. You're gonna die 3 to 5 years sooner because of diseases of affluence. You're gonna pay higher taxes, sometimes 5 times the amount of tubing, infrastructure, 5 times more in those kinds of environments. but the reason I wanted to talk to you about this today was this. People are self-reporting. So people who live in auto-dependent exurbs on the edge of big American and Canadian cities, they're reporting they're less likely to know and trust their neighbors. They're less likely to have friends and neighbors over for dinner. They're less likely to volunteer, play team sports, read the newspaper, or even vote, because there's no time. We know that people with more than a 45-minute car commute are more than 40% more likely to be divorced after 10 years if they started married at the beginning of that 10 years. So these systems are flowing into our lives, and we got to do something about it. The problem is, and I suppose this is why I was so angry during Mr. Nadeau's talk, is that American and Canadian cities, even as we pay lip service and build our bike lanes and our plazas in our central areas, we're getting more dispersed. And even if we celebrate what's happening here in Vancouver in the core, our region is getting more dispersed. It's putting more people in a vulnerable place. So 76% of the growth in our region is going to be in auto-oriented areas. So we live in a jurisdiction where our province claims to be a leader in fighting climate change, and yet we're pouring resources into, say, a new bridge that's going to spread people out across the miles, and our local politicians, sorry folks, south of the Fraser, but some of the expensive infrastructure you want to go out to, say, Langley, is going to very, very poorly populated areas. Anyway. We'll argue about that after, right? Or talk to Alex Boston, because he'll kick your ass on data. Okay, so what do we know? What do we need to do in order to create, I'll just say it, more equity and more inclusion when it comes to our movement? We need to move beyond the cores. We need to think about the edges. We need to think about connecting these places. So, sorry cyclists, this is all I'm giving you today. We are one. We love each other. We already know this, that people who move by bike are the happiest of all commuters, okay? We know that drivers, not so happy. We know that people on transit are self-reporting more fear, rage, and sadness in their journeys than any of the people moving in any other way, partly because we have disinvested so much in transit in cities. So hold on to that, because I'm just about to contradict it. One of the most extensive studies, longitudinal studies, on travel behavior and well-being came out a couple years ago from the UK. What they found was that, oh, actually, transit really does make people happy. So it's a head scratcher. You think, well, people are saying, oh, I hate my journey. How can transit make me happy? Well, this study is looking at self-reported well-being. People reporting on how happy they are considering their entire life, not on their journey, okay? And what they found was that when people switch from driving alone to active transportation, walk, bike, and yes, even transit, they are starting to self-report being happier with their entire lives. So what is going on here? Your journey is making you less happy, but you're getting happier in life. And what they figure is this, is that your transit ride is actually a walk, and then it's a ride on transit, and then it's a walk again. That is what is building happiness in these situations. So this is a powerful message for all of us who are thinking about what happens when you get off that vehicle. You get out of your car, you get out of the bus. The walking experience matters so much. It's a sacred experience and should be treated as thus. Therefore, we know when you get out of that transit stop, if you are in South Kensington in London and there's delight all around you and a slow, safe, social environment, you'll keep traveling that way. We know that if you build, as Dallas did, an extensive light rail network, you may find that ridership goes down after you spend all that money, which is what happened in Dallas, because there's nowhere to walk to. And even if there was, it's so incredibly unfriendly. We know that we're trying here in this region. I don't know how much time you have when you're here, but in some cases we're doing this well. So Newport Village in Port Moody, low in GHG, high in walkability, friendly, comfortable. Not everybody needs to live in a tower. There are towers there. There are also townhouses and houses nearby. Super, super high on walk score. And by the way, there should be a line right on the bottom of that stream, because in a couple of months, they're going to get a SkyTrain. And everybody's going to get moving that way. So we're making improvements. And it's not good enough. It's not good enough. It's not good enough because it's these people need to cross extremely busy roads just to get to the SkyTrain. It's not good enough because it's still an auto-dominated environment that doesn't value children, that doesn't value those who have trouble moving around. So I want to leave you with one example before doing a quick experiment with you, okay? And that's this, the place that's inspired me the most, and the kid who's inspired me the most in my journeys, is this little dude. He's called the vehicular cyclist in Vauban, Freiburg. So look, this kid is 5 years old. I met him on the first day of school. I was staying with his parents, and he looked up to me on this journey, and he said, "We're gonna bike to school together." And then he said, "Tomorrow, I'm gonna bike to school alone." I was like, funny kid, to his mom. And she said, no, yeah, he's gonna bike to school alone tomorrow. I said, "Well, how can that be? Are you crazy?" And she explained that in Vauban, this is the experimental community on the edge of Freiburg, Germany, that in fact, this is fine, because number one, the speed limit is 5 kilometers an hour. Not 30, which is what we sometimes consider to be safe on our slow streets, not 20, like they do in Vienna, 5, it's a walking pace. The other thing they've done, so no cars are moving swiftly here. The other thing they've done is internalize the external cost of car use. So if you move to Vauban and you have a car, no problem, you're totally welcome. You just have to spend $20,000 on a parking spot at the edge of the village. And it's a very handsome garage. And if you don't have a car, that's okay, you only pay $5,000 and you get to buy part of a park in the middle of the village. So it means it's less expensive for those who don't want to drive. It also means that everybody begins their day with that 3, 4, 5 minute walk or bike ride, biking to transit, biking to school, biking to the office. What it means is that Vauban itself is a place of an immense ease and sociability and safety, where you do send your children out early in the morning by themselves for their journeys. Where people are connecting face-to-face in an easy, trust-building way. And that's what I want to finish with. Whenever we meet face-to-face in our cities, it changes us. And I'd like you to help me with an experiment that relates in no way to the other experiment we're doing outside this room this week. It takes about 30 seconds, and I would like to invite you, anybody who doesn't want to participate in this 30-second experiment, put up your hand, please, and that's just fine. No, really, it's fine. Okay. Okay, here's what I need you to do, but please, you have to be quiet and listen to me as I lead you through it, and then you can talk when I tell you to. So, first of all, those of you who can stand, please stand. Okay. Now, what I'm going to ask you to do is, when I say go, I want you to locate someone near you who you don't know. It must be someone you don't know. I want you to greet that person. I want you to exchange something nice about each other. Just say anything nice. Maybe it's their clothing, maybe it's their smile. Go both ways. So there's a greeting, there's an exchange, you know your names, and then once you've done that, mean it, that's 20 seconds. Then I want you to take a selfie of yourselves, but pretend that you're old friends. So you need to pretend you're old friends who haven't seen each other in years. Embody that feeling. And groups of three are fine. Okay, you have 30 seconds. I mean it. Fast. Go.
Hi, I'm Bob.
Hi, Niall.
You too. Where are you from?
Oh, okay.
From Seattle, work for Seattle Neighborhood Greenway.
Hi.
Yep. I don't know if it's any more friendly for people biking and walking. I heard about that. You're working on that. That's awesome. We're trying to do that at the neighborhood level. Yeah, by the boulevard. Yeah. So we're trying to create a network of that stuff.
Yeah. Let's see those selfies! Yes. They're all friends!
Well, that sounds awesome. Sure.
Okay, stop! 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 Stop having fun! Stop! Stop it! Stop! Stop! Shh! Stop! Stop! Stop talking! Really? Stop! Sit! Stop! Stop! So Mark's like waving to me here, but our session is over because certain people speaking too long. Okay, just a quick check-in. Whoever feels like worse now than they did a minute ago, say worse. Whoever feels like just the same, go meh. Okay, whoever feels a little bit better, say better.
Better!
Okay, I'm not going to talk to you about the biochemical effects of what just happened. You already know you feel good. You already know that that intersection, even with a complete stranger, feels good. And this is why some of you do the work that you do. I don't need to explain that. What I think it's important to explain is this. We've done this experiment, really, in cities around the world. And what we've found, we do something different. We usually take a third of the room, and they can do nothing. You're not allowed to talk, not allowed to greet people. Two-thirds of the room do what all of you did. And then we survey people. We ask them, if you dropped your wallet or purse out in the city today, what are the chances you'd get it back if a stranger found it? And this is an amazing thing. Something happens to people during that experience. What we found is people's trust in strangers, not just that person, but everyone in the entire damn city, grows after that momentary experience. In Guatemala, a very dangerous place, up by 34%. New York City, 28.5%. Querétaro, again, in a very low trust environment. It caused people to change their feelings about their fellow citizens. In our other experimental work, we found that it actually changes people's attitudes and politics. So they say they would like a fairer society, they want a greener society, they want a slower city, and they're willing to pay for it. So, no, I'm not saying we all have to go out and start hugging strangers, but I do think my Tinder friend was wrong, that the work we do is about social health, it is about inclusion, it is transformative. And finally, I see you there waving at me, Mark, I know. finally, one message from John Halliwell and the happiness economists, some of whom are great people. They say the best way to improve your own personal happiness is to work together with your allies on a cause that's bigger than yourself. So let's do that together this week. Thanks for having me.
Back for an encore on Thursday when he'll be presenting the results of the emotional tours. A bit of a ceremony before our final speaker.